Dear Father Simon and the Forgiving Few, I just want to start by saying I love your show. Listen to it every day, and I love the confession slot.
Brilliant.
Right, well, forgiven then. I write to ask forgiveness from you beautiful people for a sad episode that happened back in 1999 when I was 24. It all started after a very rowdy night out at a friend's hen party in Chester. It ended up by being a very late night. I got home after 4 a.m. Taxi dropped me off. At the time, I lived alone in a lovely semi-detached house in an equally lovely and quiet cul-de-sac in North Wales. I had two cats, Chubby and Charlie. Real names, haven't changed those. I tried to locate my front keys after I'd been dropped off in my little handbag, but I couldn't find them anywhere. I was effectively locked out of my house. Now, the last time I managed to lock myself out, I got into the back garden, I knelt down and I put a small broomstick through the cat flap and knocked the back key door out of the lock. I put my hand through the cat flap and got the key. That's how I did it last time. So on this fateful night, or early morning as it was, I thought I could do the same. My first obstacle was the back gate, which I'd forgotten I had locked earlier the previous day. So I climbed and stumbled onto the bonnet of my first ever company car in my high heels, launched myself over the gate into the back garden. Luckily, I landed on the soft lawn and was relieved I was alone, as my short skirt had ended up revealing a little bit too much that was decent. This is a relevant point, by the way. I then found my small broom and went about to trying to get my little trick going and dislodging the back door key through the cat flap. Well, for some reason, I couldn't seem to keep the broom straight whilst reaching through the cat flap, and I couldn't remember if I'd even left the back door key in the lock in the first place. So I thought it'd be a good idea if I could just see if the key was in the lock. So I had a tipsy brainwave to put my head into the cat flap, which seemed more than big enough, frankly, to accommodate my head. And then if I could just see the key was in the lock, then I could carry on with my attempt to knock it out of the lock. But it didn't quite go according to plan. I knelt down and proceeded to put my head through the cat flap quite easily whilst giggling to myself and thinking, I'm so glad that no one can see what I'm doing. To my delight, the key was in the back door lock, which was a relief. So I then went to remove my head back out of the cat flap. And guess what? My ears seemed to have got stuck, so I could not get my head back out. I tried again by planting my hands firmly on the cold concrete and tried and pushed and heaved, but to no avail. So as you can imagine, I started to sober up pretty quickly and started to panic. Now, I live alone, so I couldn't shout for anyone to come and help, and it was 4:30 in the morning, and my neighbour is elderly and deaf. So after trying and trying again to dislodge my head, I started shouting help as loud as I possibly could and praying and hoping that someone in my very quiet and well-to-do cul-de-sac would hear my frantic shouts. In the meantime, my cats had got very distressed and kept pushing my face from the inside to try and get out, much to my annoyance. After what seemed like a very long time, I heard someone climbing over my gate, and I just hoped it would be a friendly neighbour. But to my complete embarrassment and shock, it was the local policeman. Apparently one of the neighbours had called the police, hearing my shouting and a bit of a commotion. The policeman climbed over the fence without jumping on the bonnet of my car, which I had done. Now, you need to know I had a bench next to my back door, and all I could hear was a muffled noise which sounded to me like crying. The policeman had to literally sit down on my bench as he couldn't stop laughing. After shouting to him through the cat flap, he understood what I had done, so went into my handbag to double check my front door keys were actually lost. Would you believe it? They were there all the time.
Oh, no.
I was even more mortified at this point, as he must have thought I was even more stupid than I looked. So this young, and I have to say quite attractive, policeman let himself in through my front door, though I could say you wouldn't know this at the time. Anyway, let himself in through the front door, let my cats out, and came and sat on the floor in my kitchen to talk it all through with me and to find out how I'd got into this state. He really was very nice, considering what a fool I'd made of myself, and he tried everything to coax my ears flat back against my head so I could get my head out of this wretched cat flap. He tried washing up liquid, he tried face cream from the bathroom, and even olive oil, but nothing was working. So he looked at me with a big smile on his face and said, I'm going to have to call the fire brigade.
Hey!
So this policeman then called the local fire station and explained the situation, and I could tell he was trying so hard not to laugh, and I heard him say, no, the full team did not have to come out, and explain the nature of the call. Just when I thought it couldn't get any worse, a fire engine roars up with lights flashing, filling the small cul-de-sac at 6 a.m. with the whole fire station, who'd turned up as they couldn't believe what the fireman had said. By this time, I was mortified beyond anything you can possibly imagine. The kind and again just my luck attractive fireman went into my bedroom and brought down a quilt to hide my modesty. My inadequate skirt was stressing them out and they had to keep chatting to me to calm me down. Anyway, to be honest, they were all lovely, even though they were trying so hard to stifle their laughter. So next up came a large saw. The plan was to cut a larger hole in my wooden back door and then a smaller saw to dislodge the cat flap. So the saw started to work, with one fireman cutting a hole around me and the other fireman in the back garden holding the duvet discreetly around my waist. You can imagine this is a delicate operation. So all I can hear is this saw cutting into my beautiful back door, and it then got caught on something, maybe a knot in the wood. The saw jumped sideways and knocks the side of my head.
Oh,
no. I saw stars, though I do think the alcohol helped numb the pain. And just when you think it couldn't get any worse, the police decided they had to call an ambulance to attend. So it went from me being alone, drunk and stuck in a cat flap, to a police car and a fire engine and now an ambulance outside my house. The fireman managed to cut a hole in my back door, get me off my knees, but I was then carried into the waiting ambulance with a now bloody plastic cat flap, that's the cat flap that is bloody, still attached to my head. I was protesting that I was fine and didn't want to go to hospital, but they insisted. So, again, just when you think it can't get any worse, I'm wheeled into my local A&E on a stretcher with a plastic cat flap around my neck, which was eventually removed by a bemused consultant at the hospital who sent me home with a packet of paracetamol for my headache, which was caused more by my shame and the hangover. There are no words, really, to describe how embarrassing the whole experience has been, and all I wanted to do was to crawl into bed to hide under my duvet forever. But the policeman, who originally responded to my call for help, popped round to make sure I was okay. She adds, euphemistically. Anyway, my back door was secured. So I'd like to seek forgiveness to all my unfortunate neighbours who were all woken up by my drunken shouts for help at 4 a.m. on a quiet Sunday morning and then having the street filled with all the emergency services in turn. Also forgiveness from my then employer when I told him I had no idea how two large scratches appeared on the bonnet of my new company car. And forgiveness to my cats, who will never understand why they will... the current cats, that is, who will never understand why they will not get a cat flap fitted into the back door. As you can imagine, I was the talk of my street for a very long time. I became known as the Cat Flap Woman, and from that morning onwards, I put my house up for sale and I moved to another town. So I love your show and would love it if this was included in your show. So Heather, we've changed the name, though the names of the cats are genuine, tells us an interesting story, which you can understand, I think, how she was very, very embarrassed. It was just an innocent hen night and ended up A&E, all the emergency services. What do you say?
Bit extreme to sell her house, don't you think? I mean, the neighbours didn't see her in her...
Well, they did.
Think they did?
Yes. Unbelievably, I shortened the story.
Right,
really?
Okay. Some lovely images came to mind during that, not least the cat flap around her neck as she was on the stretcher going to hospital. I just love that story. It's fantastic.
And the policeman arriving with woman with her head through the door.
And trying to, you know, rub olive oil on her ears and stuff. That's just great. It's worse than the toe in the tap, isn't it, when you get stories about getting your toe caught in the tap during your bath time. I think, it's a great story, so I'm going to forgive.
What do you say, Brother Matt?
What a story that is. Absolutely superb. But I would say you've now ruined the emergency services for that story, because they live for that. They live for the one call that comes in of, we've got a young lady caught in a cat flap. Care to come and get her out?
Whole station.
Yes, I'll go. So they'll never get a call like that again. And they'll all have been regaling themselves with that story for a while. So I am definitely going to forgive. What a superb...